This is your girl, Lady Shantae Frederick.
And I'm Pastor David Frederick.
And this is Come Get Your Life with the Fredericks. And so we are back tonight. We hope that everybody is doing well. I know that yesterday was some history in the making. We celebrated Vice President Harris, who is the first Black Southeast Asian,
I think that's what they say.
Woman president, vice president, which was a major accomplishment, and also President Biden, who is now our president. There was a lot of good and negative things that I heard, but I focused on the positive things because I was really, really excited and proud.
So you didn't get
the both of them.
So you won't, you know, you weren't disappointed when the U-Haul pulled up in front of the White House to, you know,
when they was taking Melania's stuff out in Louis Vuitton bags. Yeah. No, I wasn't disappointed. Okay. That's just me. Right. But the good thing about being a Christian and being an American is that we can agree to disagree.
Yeah, exactly.
We can have different opinions and views and still respect one another. Yeah. And so that's what Pastor and I pride ourselves on. We have some people.
So you weren't trying to break in the White House because you weren't trying to climb the wall and get through one of the windows?
No, that was not me. I was not one of those.
Thank you, God.
But I'm just excited and happy. I want to throw this disclosure and understand that as believers, they are not our spiritual leaders.
Right. Absolutely. Absolutely.
They are not our spiritual leaders. And so we don't look to them for spiritual advice. That is what the house of God is for. Your ministry, your church, your organization, your place of worship.
Yeah.
And so.
Yeah. So don't be disappointed by their behavior. Don't, you know, you expect them to do what they do because they're not spiritual guides.
They're not
giving us godly advice. They're not there for that reason.
No, they aren't. So please like and share on tonight because we wanted to talk about that, but we also want to get back on our hot topic. Do you remember what the topic is?
Absolutely, but I want you to share it with us tonight. I want you to bring us all back into it.
So tonight we are continuing our segment on pursuing your mate or being pursued. And last week we started the segment on knowing thyself. Is there anything you want to talk about from last week about knowing thyself?
I cannot stress enough how important it is to know yourself when you're talking about getting in a relationship with someone. It can be a relationship on all different levels. It can be the fact of what church you go to. It can be in the fact of the kind of job that you are in. It can be in the kind of field that you want to go in. It's vitally important to know yourself, especially when you're talking about being a part of somebody else's life for the rest of your life. It's good to know yourself and what you expect out of yourself.
That's right. And so tonight we're going to dive right in with the continuation of knowing yourself. And some of the things that we talked about last week is knowing how your credit score is, how you pay your bills.
My God, if you pay
your bills on time. And remember, now we're talking about pursuing your mate. So we are talking about things that would affect your marriage, right?
Or affect that relationship and on all levels.
On all levels. So if you are one and you know that your credit is poor, and you're paying 21% interest rate on a car. Yeah, you might want to get that taken care of before you even want to start dating. Because a lot of times if you have poor credit or you don't budget well or you don't pay your bills on time, it's going to be pretty hard to go somewhere and date somebody, right?
To do some things. You know, I've
been money.
Yeah, because they're part of our counseling session. We do a lot of marriage counseling for individuals that desire spiritual counseling and biblical sound doctrine counseling. It's a credit is a significant part. We ask the individuals to actually bring in a credit report,
right?
Because a credit report reflects on your behavior or the things that you find important. Now, we can also, if you know how to read a credit report, you can read up there and tell that some people had a rough time, if it's just a rough time or a way of life. Your credit report can reflect if you had a rough moment or a loss of job or loss of family member or some significant things that might hit your finances. You can see that on credit reports. And so in getting to know yourself, you might need to pull up your credit report to see how you have been handling your finances. Now, what you need to do is do all three, though. You don't just need to do just one, Equifax, TransUnion, all of those, so that you can get a true picture of how you handle money. And so when you're doing that, it tells you how you're paying your bills. It tells you how your credit score is. Credit score is more than just paying your bills. Now, we want to make sure everybody understand that. Because if you get a five-star job or a job that
a corporate job. Jobs, period. It doesn't even really have to be.
Well, my job pulled my credit report. They pulled
it. It doesn't have to be a corporate job. A lot of companies are pulling criminal backgrounds and credit report. That's another thing.
Yeah, criminal background.
Listen, is the person you're interested in, do they have a criminal background? You want to know that before you go and try to take a trip with your boo and he can't or she can't obtain a passport to go with you on certain trips and things like that because of a background. So you need to make sure these are things. Tonight we're going over things that maybe you haven't thought of about yourself and or your mate. But remember last week we said you can't expect something out of a mate, a potential individual that you haven't done yourself or that you can't produce yourself.
And
right?
That's what I wanted to bring out. The fact, do you have a criminal record? Do you have a
poor credit? That's
do
right.
you have these things? And that's how you gauge yourself. Now, listen, the first lady said again, we talked about it last week. You can't expect from other people the things that you haven't accomplished yourself. So don't cheat anybody. Now, I know that sounds very negative. I know that seems very, that causes insecurity in people. But listen, everybody has had a rough time.
Right.
Everybody has had.
No one's perfect.
Exactly. But you got to be realistic when you were talking about entering into somebody else's life. They got to know what to expect. So you need to be honest with yourself. And that's what this segment is about. Knowing yourself.
Know yourself. Know if you have credit cards that are over the limit.
Oh, my God.
Don't try to go take somebody out.
Or you got 15 credit cards and
listen,
you should be having about 2 or 3.
Listen, take somebody out and can't even pay for the meal because your credit card is over the limit. Or you can pay for the meal and you looking, can you get the tip?
or you give your credit card at dinner and the waitress walk away with it, then come back with that card.
And then you have to pull another one out.
Or now, you know, in some cases that they have a right to cut your credit card up right there in front of you.
Oh, that's a whole fight.
Yeah, that's all.
I'm sorry, babe.
Go ahead.
We have Elder Linda Patterson that says, that is a must. You will be in trouble for not taking care of your credit. That's right, because once you're married, how are you going to find a place to stay together unless you plan on moving in with the person that already has established credit, like obtaining things. You know, we all know, for the most part, I hope we all know that our credit helps us in more than just purchasing things.
Yeah.
It helps with your
insurance
rate, right?
Oh, God, yes.
When they're looking at your insurance rate, when you're looking to get lights cut on, just different things. measures how much you're going to pay,
yeah,
or how much you're going to save.
Yeah, and because, you know, if you go if you got bad credit and you go get a car and it's over 7%, well, now it's over 4%. If it's over 4%, some people, I know some people personally that got all the way up to 17%. What's happening
with
that?
No, I've heard of someone with 21% interest on a used car. I don't know if it was one of those buy here, pay here.
And see, what you're doing, that's very significant, because what you're doing is 20%, and going with First Lady's figures, 20% of your payment is interest and interest alone. And people don't understand how that works. You are diving into a pay period where you keep paying and keep paying, but it takes you longer.
Right.
You
know, you're wasting money.
You're wasting money and your time.
You're wasting money in interest.
Yes.
Come get your life with the Fredericks. How long have you been on your job?
Oh, my
God.
Come on
here. How long have you been on your job? So this is a thing where oftentimes I was doing some research, and the studies are showing that millennials will not stay on a job longer than 5 years.
Right. Yeah.
Prior to that, most people would stay on their job an average 10 years.
Yeah. Yeah.
We are running into couples, singles who are changing jobs maybe every 6 to 9 months.
And believe it, people, it's really happening. That is a reflection of sometimes instability. They're not stable, or they're not focused.
That's a whole lot of stuff that can play into that.
Yeah, yeah.
Please like and share. Please like this and share. Yeah, so you really want to get to the bottom of why they can't.
Well, sometimes also too, when you're young and you don't know what you really like, you'll find younger people, you know, under 25, under 28, that are exploring different avenues of living accommodations. Mm-hmm. So they go from job to job. You got to remember that aspect. And there's nothing wrong with that, because you're trying to find yourself. I highly suggest that you don't get in a relationship unless that other person knows that you don't know that about yourself.
I don't know.
That's about knowing yourself.
I've asked to see you pretend, and the people that we have encountered, they are not in their early 20s.
Well, yeah.
After you have reached at least age 27, going into 30, you should have
an idea, especially.
Right. I mean, I know that things are changing a lot, but if you are a person that you just really can't keep a job, that's what we're talking about.
Yeah.
Not a young person who's trying to find their way and figure out what it is that keeps their interest as far as career interest. But if you have a problem keeping a job, then there's going to be money problems. And so if you know you can't hold a job down, you might want to hold off on pursuing your mate, is all I'm saying.
I would highly suggest that also. I would highly suggest that.
Okay.
Because it causes an individual to question if you can actually take care of them or help support the union, or because if you don't know yourself, mm-hmm, and you're still trying to discover yourself, they may be things about you that you don't know. Then you try to hook a person into your reality. And I'm trying to walk lightly here.
You don't want to be coming home.
Yeah.
And the only reason why I say your man is because I'm a woman, and your husband wants to be an electrician 1 week.
Yeah, exactly.
And then he comes back and 6 months later he decides he wants to be an artist or a rapper. I mean, I don't know. I say rapper because I've been seeing a lot of men over 35 wanting to be a rapper.
Trying to bring it in. They're trying to be the 50 Cent.
God bless you. God bless you. All I know is that when you get to a certain age,
yeah,
and when you're pursuing a mate, you want to have some consistency,
yeah,
in what you're doing. And some stability. You want to see stability. And so, I mean,
especially
you don't want to go from
if their kids are
another.
Involved, you want to have all these things out of the way before you involve, especially with kids, you know, bringing kids into the picture, because kids, regardless of what people say, kids need stability.
They really
need stability to grow, properly grow.
Okay, here's another one. Are you domesticated?
Oh my God.
Can you cook, clean? Do you do laundry?
Can you work every day? those are things that you really got to know.
Or do we need to hire somebody to do it? These are questions that, yeah, I mean, you need to know who's going to be preparing the meals, right?
Yeah, and you need to know, can you sit down with your significant one about yourself and share those responsibilities? Are you to the point that you think you too good to clean a house, men? Or you think you too good to wash clothes or do dishes or or those types of things? Are you too good to do yard work?
Pastor.
Are you too good to do yard work? Can you trim the bushes? Can you
That's not in my hedges? Qualifications.
Can you do these guys? Are you domesticated enough where, you know,
I do the inside of the house. I don't do anything on the outside of the house.
You want these things.
You wash dishes, Pastor.
We just want to keep moving with the
segment. You do laundry, Pastor. Those are the questions that I didn't ask.
And there's things that you don't want to have to discover later on if you can get them up front. So that's saying know yourself.
Brother Greg said they're trying to be 25 cents, not 50 cents. That's a good one. That's a good one, Brother Greg. How about how, we talked about it last week. How do you handle conflict? Did we talk about that?
I think we did, but I believe that we need to go into a little bit more how to handle conflict.
Okay, now remember we're talking about knowing thyself when you're pursuing a mate or being pursued. And one of the things is how do you handle conflict? Do you
I want to really dig into this first, lady, because the reality of it is, honestly, the reality of it is that people don't know themselves to the degree of how they can handle conflict because they've been living with themselves so long, they think that their behavior or their attitude or what they say is okay. It may not be received very well from someone else, especially someone that you love and care about. So you got to know how you handle conflict and disclose that. You know, a lot of people say, watch, you know, you date for a good 6 months to a year so that you can see that. All those kinds of things. And you don't want to fake it. You want to be real. That was one thing I found out about First Lady when I was betrothing her or dating her, seeking her out, was that, you know, she was very transparent about a lot of things. And you need to know yourself. Now, the reason I'm bringing this up is because I need to know, I'm just dealing with me, I need to know, can I handle conflict when it arises?
That's
and
good.
How do I handle it? Do I run from it?
That's good.
You know, do I face it with anger or hostility? Right. Or am I so insecure that I have to badger the person back? Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Because there's hostility approaching me. Instead of shutting down, mm-hmm. I should embrace it at a level that the person feel comfortable talking to me so that there won't be any flashbacks or, you know, how people say start talking mm-hmm. and then they start going back in the past because they feel that they're not being received. Mm-hmm. I'm being light on words here. You know, they start digging at things that a person used to, you used to say this and you used to say that. That's a sign of insecurity that you're not being heard or you're not being taken serious. One of the things that First Lady told me that she will not tolerate being called out of her name. And so in a moment of hostility, I got to watch what I say, because that was one of the things. She was not going to take that. And anyway, so I got to find out, can I do that? You know, I got to make sure I can do that.
I think he's done a very good job with that. Also with handling conflict, you want to talk about it in advance. If you are one who shuts down, and I know some people say that, like you said, they run off, like they don't deal with it and they run off. But then you have some people who just literally shut down and won't deal. So you have to know if you are one that shuts down, if you are one who is aggressive, if you are one who becomes physical.
Yeah.
You have people, that's another thing. Are you physically, mentally, emotionally, or financially abusive?
Oh God.
Right?
Yes.
So in handling conflict, are you aggressive? Are you intimidating?
Yeah. Yeah.
Right?
And these are some of the things you can ask family members. Family members can help you out with this. They can ask, you know, family members that want to be honest with you, and good friends. Good friends can help you with this.
And then work on it. You know, if you are pursuing someone and you know that you don't handle conflict well and you talk about it in the beginning, there are ways that you can work on dialoguing or dealing with conflict. Some may say, listen, let's not talk about it right now because I'm upset or I'm angry. Let's go our separate ways. do continue on our day or whatever it is that we would like to do, and then come back and talk about it.
You got to know your triggers.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's knowing yourself.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
conflict is going to happen
it's
in a relationship.
It's going to happen.
And if someone says, I've never argued with my boyfriend or my spouse or my girlfriend or my, you know, whoever, your fiance, then you may want to question that relationship. You may want to date a little longer.
Yeah.
So you want to make sure, though, this is a very touchy topic, because when conflict arises, I'm not going to say love goes out the door, but I don't care how fine he is, how fine she is, how intelligent the individual is, how anointed the individual is.
Yes, but let's bring it to the
those
table.
Those things aren't at the forefront when you're in a disagreement or when you're in conflict.
And you sanctified Holy Ghost filled Christians, the ones that believe that God leads you to wake up and go to sleep, that's fine. When conflict comes in, everybody thinks it's the devil. That's not necessarily the devil. Mm-hmm. It said the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Meaning that there's something on the inside of you that's insecure when your anger boils to the point that you are intimidated enough to lash out to someone. Or you have sometimes it's a people that can't really express their emotions and don't know how to express their emotions. You got to know where your triggers are. You got to know where, you know, for me, if I ever feel that I'm to the point, and I know First Lady, when I get to the point, I feel like I got an anger, I will leave the room.
You shut down.
I will leave the room. I will shut down. Because, see, I know my triggers. Because anger to me is not a verbal thing, it's a combative state. That means you are testing me as an individual. That's just my weakness. That
and
type
we
of talk, thing.
I think we shared this about our marriage, even though, I mean, you know, we had to date in order to be married.
Yeah.
We shared this last week on one of the questions was, do you like to argue or do you argue? And so with us, my husband will shut down. And with me, I like to talk about it right then on the spot.
No matter where you are.
Listen, it's going down right here. We're going to talk about it right here. And so now, I think we're in 12 years of marriage, 13 years of being together. We've worked on that, obviously.
Yeah.
We don't
it
do
takes
that
work
anymore. But you want to start having the conversation. Mother says, what about being submissive in your marriage? Now, because we're talking about pursuing a mate and or being pursued, and we're not actually talking about marriage, we're using our marriage as an example, but we're not talking about being married, it's an excellent question, because being submissive doesn't start when you get married.
Exactly. I thank
being
you for saying
a
it
wife
right. yeah.
doesn't start, and I don't want to jump ahead on future things that we're going to talk about, but being a wife doesn't start when you
get
married.
Or
because the Bible
declares,
husband. He that findeth a wife findeth of good things. So he's looking for the wife, and she's already a wife when he meets her.
Yeah.
And so being submissive is something that you can put into practice prior to getting married, while you're dating. And so we're not going to quite cover what submissive means.
Yeah, I want
because
to
that's
that.
A whole
another subject. We
baby,
will deal
that's
with
a
it.
Whole nother category. Lord have mercy. Hi, Robin. We see you on here. So you want to make sure that you are talking about how to handle conflict, because they are going to arise. And you need to know if you are an individual that is, like we said before, physically, emotionally,
and knowing your triggers, like we said,
or financially abusive. These things people don't talk about, but you need to talk about it during the dating period.
Give us an example of being financially abused.
Okay, so being financially abusive is when one party works. So I'll give you an example just using us. Let's say that pastor is the sole breadwinner. He's working, and I'm a stay-at-home mom or stay-at-home wife, and he's bringing in most of the money. If I don't do what he wants me to do, then he withholds certain monies from me. Let's just say both of us are working, and I want to do something with my money, and he tells me no. You can't spend your money, or he's aggressive in controlling over the way that I spend my money or want to spend my money. Instead of having the conversation, he's dominating how the money is being spent, leaving the house, and you have to sneak to spend money. That's abusive. if you have to sneak to spend
do certain things, yes.
money, and I'm not talking about sneaking to spend money because you really don't want him to know.
That ain't a part of abusive right there.
No.
That's not being abusive right there.
We're talking about with the attitude and the motive of being domineering and aggressive
and controlling.
And manipulating.
And
right.
controlling.
So that's an example of being financially abusive.
Now, there's a difference between being abusive and being focused. I want to make sure I get that out there because a lot of times, if you have goals and you have set goals, if you have done yourself this way, we're getting back to knowing yourself. Mm-hmm. If you have done yourself this way, when you meet the individual, you got to see if they carry the same qualities, because it will become frustrating for the individual that carry these types of characteristics in a relationship with someone who's opposite, and you don't know why you're having problems. That's because you didn't know yourself. You know, if you are a very financial goal-oriented individual and you're trying to accomplish certain things with your finance, regardless of how much you have, you can set goals for yourself and the one that you are trying to be with, and they are not, you don't want to be abusive to them because you are different.
Right.
You know, you got to question, you got to watch that kind of stuff because, you know, everybody's not the same.
Listen, though, you also have to watch it can be male or female who don't spend the money on bills, but rather get a new dress or purchase some nice red bottoms or get the latest Jordans or buy the
That's
latest
a type of abuse.
PS5. You know, if you have money and you know your bills need to be paid and you neglect to pay the bills, this is why you're single. Because you want to go out to the latest concert or you want the latest handbag or whatever it is that you want to purchase, you're being neglectful. And when you get into a relationship that leads to marriage, ultimately, because that's what we're talking about, I'm going to keep reiterating that leads to marriage, those same behaviors, those same characters is going to go into that marriage. And being in a marriage and looking, expecting your husband to pay a bill and he done bought some new Jordans or he bought a nice briefcase or a nice suit.
Yeah.
Because my husband don't buy Jordans and he doesn't play
none of those things,
game systems. So, or, you know, whatever it is, and didn't take care of the bills,
that's abusive.
A problem.
That's abusive.
Yes, that is. And so that we're moving on, make sure you talk about if you have any medical histories, any medical conditions or issues, if you take medication. People, please hear me when I say this, my sisters and brothers. If you plan on having children and you're getting married, you plan on having children, find out your family medical history. A lot of this stuff is not taught about in our community, the African-American community.
Especially.
And this isn't just for the African-American community, but because I am African-American, I know the culture. Make sure you have the conversation before you start having children, because that's a big thing. You know, if your family has a history of diabetes or your family has a history of heart problems, you want to make sure that you know that prior to going in. If your partner is on a cocktail of medications and you know that you don't want to be in a relationship where you're always going to the pharmacy picking up medication, or your the individual that you're looking to marry, you know, isn't physically capable or medically capable of doing things that you want to do. Those are things that you need to talk about. Those are things that you need to know.
And I said this past Sunday on the Sunday service that real love, in order to really love someone, you got to know them.
Right.
You got to know them. Now, if you really know the person and you know yourself and you choose to go in a relationship with them, you got to go with the understanding that's the love part. This is what it comes with. Because you don't want to abuse someone or neglect someone of something that you did not research or look into.
That's right, Pastor.
It is your job as an individual to know yourself, to absolutely know yourself, to be real with the person that you might be interested in, so that when you do go in that relationship, you don't turn abusive because of something you did not know.
Now, or neglectful.
Or
because
neglectful.
If you know the person already suffers from a condition or from an illness, and then you all end up being married, and now you don't want to help or assist or be there for the person, that's not the individual's fault.
Right.
Knew that from the beginning.
Now, so we're not talking about if it happens once you get married. That's
because
afterwards.
You already know the vow says for better or for
worse. For rich or poor.
Listen, so sickness that,
that's why
health.
You got to know yourself.
You have to know yourself.
You know, if anyone that has a situation and you engage into that relationship, knowing that that situation is there, and now that that situation has become apparent in marriage, your love is not really real. Your love is not to the extent, because they told you up front, hey, this is how I was, this is how I am. So you got to know, can I bear this out? Can I deal with this? So you got to really know yourself. And one more example is that when before I met First Lady, I just came out of divorce about 4-5 years of a divorce. I was beginning to look, and I met a young lady that smoked, and I hate smoke.
Hey.
I hate smoking. And so as soon as I found out, and I didn't find out until about 2 or 3 months after getting to know her, and I smelled it, but one time we were sitting down eating, we ate, and she left the restaurant, and she smoked. And she got took out a cigarette and started smoking. I said, oh, I didn't know you. I smelled it on her, but I didn't want to bring it up to be offensive because I didn't know for sure. But then she said, yeah, I smoke, and you know, it's not a regular thing, but I do. And then I knew that I was going to be abusive. I knew that, what I mean by abusive, because
yeah,
I hate smoke.
Abusive.
What I mean by abusive is that, okay, say if we got married and now we're married and you come into bed smelling like smoke, I'm going to turn over. I'm going to turn away from you. I'm not going to want to be around you constantly.
That's not abusive. That's neglectful, Pastor.
Okay, being neglectful. Yeah. Being neglectful. What I mean by abusive is I knew it, but now I'm taking
it
upon myself.
That's not abusive, though. That's neglectful.
Being neglectful then. Right. Being neglectful in a situation. I don't think it's fair to the individual to ask them of something that I can't really tolerate.
Right. Being abusive is verbally attacking her for smoking, and you know she smokes.
Well, I'm saying things, that too. That's something I will do. That's what I would have done. I would have kept bringing it up all the time.
So those are some things that you want to consider as well. If the person smokes, if the person drinks, if you have a problem with them drinking wine, and we're talking about believers and non-believers. Of course, you know, our background and foundation is our faith is in Jesus Christ. And so if you know that you can't handle your mate drinking, having a beer every day or drinking wine to unwind,
don't bother them.
some even do recreational drugs. You'll be surprised how many.
Yeah. Okay.
Praise God. And so you have to make sure that these are things that are discussed. We hope that this segment has have you reflecting on yourself. Those that are single, those who are dating, and those who are engaged, that you will take a moment or some moments and reflect on yourself. When we reflect on ourselves and the things, how we are, and the things that we can do to be better, when we are in relationships, our outlook, our mind, we always talk about renewing the mind. Our outlook is different on the individual that we are dating and or looking to be married to. So if you need to go back and look at this live to get some ideas about yourself and how to look at yourself and view yourself and think about, have the conversation of why some relationships haven't worked in the past for you, or maybe why you aren't married and you want to be married. Look at yourself. Take a look at yourself. Let's stop looking at the other person just for a minute, because a lot of times we attract what we are.
Exactly.
And so if we take a look at ourselves and start reevaluating oneself, then maybe when he finds you, or maybe when you find her this time, it'll work.
Yeah.
We know that Jesus, having God at the core of everything that we do, is imperative. So we never leave that out.
Never.
And we're going to talk about the spiritual side and the spiritual aspect of this on next week. But we wanted to get down to the nitty gritty this week a little bit on diving into yourself and knowing yourself.
And learning, a little bit more. And the thing, too, is that we got to learn how to appreciate ourselves, First Lady. We got to learn how to love ourselves. You know, I was in counseling session. One of those things that counselors, you got to learn to love yourself.
That's right.
So you don't have to depend on anyone to continuously to love you.
And so thank you so much for joining us tonight. Please like and share. We'll be back on next Thursday, 7 p.m. Come get your life with the Fredericks. We love you all.
And be blessed.